Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you all are doing well. Should I start again, Isha?
No, that's all right.
Okay. So I am Sai Ghule and I am the head PR of AICVS. And today with us, we have a very special guest because she is our very own senior. Her name is Rutuja Kolhe. So Rutuja Kolhe is a technical analyst at Citi. She is a machine learning and augmented reality enthusiast. She is a natural language processing geek and a business intelligence zealot. She is the recipient of Facebook School of Innovation Augmented Reality Program Scholarship with UNICEF as a project partner. She'll be sharing with the basic types of realities, AR, VR, mixed, characteristics of AR, Spark AR opportunities, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat filters, and we'll also talk about her Facebook School of Innovation program experience. This will be a very insightful and very interesting session. So over to you, Rutuja.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Am I visible?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll be presenting right now. Give me 1 second, please. Since Sai has already walked us through the flow, I'll just repeat some stuff for you all. My name is Rutuja Kolhe, and today I'll be talking about, or I'll be your tour guide in the world of augmented reality. We'll be talking about what is augmented reality, how does it work, why is it better than all of the others. Then we'll be talking about the differences about AR, VR, mixed reality, the mechanisms of augmented reality, Spark AR Studio, as well as we'll have a look into the Facebook School of Innovation. I hope this becomes an interactive session. So if at a particular slide you have any questions, you can ask them at the end of every section which are divided or at the last Q&A. And if you like a particular slide, if you have comments about any kind of GIF which I've included, it will be really nice, so that I hope it's not a one-way communication. Let's begin, shall we? Okay. Coming up with augmented reality. First of all, let's start with science fiction. This word is what we've grown up listening to via books, movies, and everything else. We were promised quite a lot. We were promised ray guns or teleportation or even flying cars. Everything, all of that hasn't panned out yet. But there is one technology literally which ties the fiction to reality, and it is known as augmented reality. Here we have a few examples of the same. Now, over the period of decades, different kind of technologies, applications have been emerging, and one of them is AR. AR is no fiction, it is something which is happening right now. Right from the filters which we use to any kind of try-on shops which we'd go, everything is AR. I have a very small video for you all in the next slide, which will give you a gist of how cool or how interesting AR is. This is just a very small example of what AR can do or what AR is. Now, okay, I'm sorry, yeah. Let's move on to the basic introduction of augmented reality. Starting with what exactly is this AR or this buzz term I'm talking about. Well, AR isn't anything different, but it is something, it is a technology which expands our physical view. Now, how does it do so? Well, what it does is it takes some digital content or a virtual element and it places it in our own reality in the form of layers. And bringing that virtual element in our reality is known as augmented reality. Now let's dive a bit deeper into it. The basic crux of AR is that we want to enhance how we perceive our general reality. And that is, we want to augment that reality, and that's why it's called as augmented reality. Right from the Pokemon Go game, which we all played, where we point a Pikachu which didn't exist in real life, but we could see in our own screens, was augmented reality. Well, so is the filters which we use on day-to-day basis. Now, why should we go for AR? Well, AR is a complete ball changer in that way, because it has the possibility to change whole interaction what we have with the world. In the sense that instead of using mouse or keyboard, we can just do things with a swipe of our hands. And who wouldn't like that, right? AR has a wide range of scope of applications, right? From gaming, medicine, education, business, retail, fashion, jewelry, you name it, and AR is there. Second, you can see the stats which are projected on the screen, which shows that AR is an up-and-coming market. And the best part about AR is, even though it's new, it has been talked about, it has been taken upon by mega giants like Google, Facebook, Amazon. So the finance is unlimited. That's why the opportunities which are directly proportional also tend to increase. So if you were to work in AR, it will be a definite boost for your career in terms of opportunity, creativity, as well as money. Now, let us talk about the comparison of the 2D screen-based experience which we usually follow in our day-to-day lives. What makes AR different? Well, it is more natural, it is more intuitive. As I said, that why not use hands or facial expressions when you can just, instead of the keyboard or the normal touchpad? Second is the ability to interact the whole space. In the sense that why should we stick to our computer screens when we have the whole world around us and we can just move, and as we move along, we'll have those elements in our own space. So basically, the elements are adjusting to us instead of we adjusting to our own virtualizations. Next, a good part of the world wears glasses. And wouldn't it be cool that our glasses do things for us or project things for us instead of we opening up a phone or a laptop to look up things? Last advantage which we have, which is like a really major advantage I would like to focus on, is the ability of the computer to hide when it is not in use. Let me explain. Basically, when I need a computer, I have it with me in the form of a glass or a lens. So when I need it, it's there. But when I don't need it, instead of a phone, which we really need to worry about, it just camouflages itself in the background. That makes the user experience as well as the way we interact with the world way easier. Let us now look at a bit history. So first of all, we can see that the sword of Damocles was when AR was actually started. You can see it's quite old. But the thing is that we've come to know AR in like right from 2000, when AR toolkit was launched and it changed the whole ball game. Because that is the time when we came to know about how AR is used in retail, sports, or wearables. The term AI, though, was coined in the year 1990. Now, let us look at the comparison between AR, VR, and mixed reality. Something which is very confusing for everybody. Well, virtual reality, which has been the pioneer of realities in everywhere, is often confused with AR, or AR is considered as a subterm of VR. But no, AR and VR are completely different terminologies. Let me explain it better. Virtual reality is basically projecting a different virtual reality on top of your view. So basically, you are taken into a world which is completely different and which has no relation whatsoever with your real life world. So if you want, VR can take you to Hogwarts, to Mordor, or anywhere you want, even Asgard. The best part about virtual reality is that imagination is truly the limit. While the disadvantage is that you lose your sense of connection with the real world because you wear a headset and you are in a different world altogether. Here is a simple example of how virtual reality works, or how does it make you feel. Next, we can say that how does VR work? Well, VR works in a very simple manner where we have a viewport, or if you have a device from which our camera can view, from which our eyes can view something, and that something is created by a device which has a particular software embedded in it, which is coded and which makes the whole experience. So basically, that experience is in that device, and we take ourselves using our eyes into that experience and we completely immerse ourselves there. The major competitors in VR, well, it started with Google. Google came up with Google Glass. Then the next thing which Google, I guess 2 years back, started was the Google Cardboard, where using the smartphone, you could be taken into a different VR experience. After that, everybody started launching their own things, where we have Oculus, we have PlayStation, we have HTC Valve. Now let us look at augmented reality. Now, since you know what augmented reality is, I will try to explain it in the similar format so that you know the difference between AR and VR. Well, VR takes you to a different world. AI brings that world to you. So in your world, if you want a Pikachu to exist, it will. If you want a Shrek to exist, it will. AR superimposes all the computer-generated images on the user's view of the world. That is the physical view, through our cameras or through any kind of headsets we wear. The best part about AR is that many users can have the same experience at the same time. This is one example where I'm projecting something which doesn't exist, but you think it does. Another example of such superimposition will be the Bitmoji we use in Snapchat, where we can superimpose our own Bitmoji into the real-life background, where I can make my Bitmoji sit on the bed where I am sitting beside it. Now, how does it work? Well, there are two key elements in working of any kind of AR. We require the camera and the software. Camera is required to understand what kind of environment am I working with, what are the planes, what are the surfaces, what are the objects. And the second is the software, which is responsible for capturing all this information, taking and evaluating that, making particular positions are sure that we can project them, and then actually projecting those computer-generated images there. It's as simple as that. Then we have the famous debate of Apple versus Google. Well, Apple launched the AR kit and Google launched the AR core. The differences between AR kit and AR core are, AR kit is something which is very easy to use. It's Apple's basic aim in launching that was that everybody should be able to use it. While AR core has lots and lots of features. In this debate, if you ask my personal bias, I would support Google, because Google has been the pioneer in virtual reality as well. And that's why they have held the upper hand here. Now comes the basic section, which is the mixed reality. Mixed reality is the hybrid of both of them, and it aims to offer the best of both worlds. Let me explain you with an example. So basically, we'll be having a headset like we have in those of AR, like we have those in VR. But instead of taking us to a different world, that headset will be having glasses, so we can look into the real world. But since it's our headset, we'll be having the virtual elements of AR in that. Now, the problem in general AR is due to the computing powers, we can't run smooth rendering as it is done in VR. But MR, or the mixed reality, ensures that both the smooth rendering as well as the connection to real world is ensured. Now look at the graph. Here we have the human, we have the environment, and we have the computer. And the amalgamation of all of that is known as mixed reality. Also, right now, if you ask me that where all of us are working, we have the HCI, I guess IT department has an elective about it too, where we'll be working and we'll be making sure that how easier is the interface for users to interact with computers. And when you include the environment factor in it too, you come to MR. There are two basic major pioneers in MR, where we have Microsoft HoloLens and we have Magic Leap. Well, after Google Glass was launched, everybody enjoyed it, but it turned out to be a flop because it wasn't adapted or it didn't have that particular features which everybody wanted. Even after that failure, Microsoft took it up to itself that it wanted to launch HoloLens just to make sure that there are really, really sharp rendering images, smooth flows, which we can view in real life. It is not restricted to a particular small smartphone like in AR. Second is Magic Leap. Magic Leap is a very interesting project. I would really like if you Google about it. Magic Leap 1 is what works in augmented reality, but we have Magic Leap 2, which is funded by Google, and they have been very secretive about it since the last 2 years. What they claim, though, is that they are going to provide by the end of this year a magical cinematic experience using mixed reality. What they are going to do basically is they are trying to make sure that all the elements which they are created are from a user's eye perspective. So basically, when we'll be viewing them via a headset, spectacle, or any kind of device which they come up with, we'll fool our brains into thinking that it is something which is very real because it has been shot from that perspective or created from that perspective. So there will be a very thin line between actual reality and virtualization. Now, let us consider the graph of realities. We have the virtual environment here. We have the real environment here. Virtual reality is almost close to virtual environment, bit far from the real environment, That is why virtual reality has no connection to the real environment. Then we have the augmented reality, which is a bit closer to the real environment. It does have virtual elements, but its actual connection to virtual environment is very less. And when we combine the augmented reality and virtual reality, we come together and we have this very nice branch of mixed reality, which has been growing, which has been booming. It is something which all of us have been trying. And if that happens, it is going to be a whole new domain for everybody to work. And the user experience is going to be very, very smooth. Let me summarize it for you all. Well, as you can see, that in real environment, in virtual environment, you have no connection with the real world. In the augmented reality, we have a real world and digital information is overlay on top of it. And in merged reality, we have both of them which are intertwined. In augmented reality, one thing we should always remember is that the real world is the centerpiece and all these virtual elements revolve all around it. And in merged reality or mixed reality, we try to strike a simple balance between real and physical environment, a trade-off sort of, where we understand or where we try to make sure that we have enough virtual element which will make sure that they don't exist in real life, but they are real enough that we feel that they exist in real life. Now let's look about the AR concepts. Let's start with the type of AR experiences. There are two kinds of AR experiences. We have the static AR experience and the interactive AR experience. Now, the static AR experience is basically that the user is viewing the digital content via simple hand gestures or face gestures. And it is called static because it is limited to the small screen of the user, like the smartphone screen. An example of it is filters. You have a filter. Suppose confetti is coming out or we have blown the confetti. Apart from the phone, when you look here and there is no confetti. The confetti exists only in your phone. It is static to that particular kind of image. That is why we call it as a static AR experience. Let us now look at the interactive AR experience. Interactive AR experience is the real example which I showed you at the very beginning, where you don't need a small screen. You need some kind of glasses which will expand your view. So you interact with the elements. So they, how you move, they move. And that is how these experiences have a wider range, very difficult to implement. But at the end, the results are really, really fruitful compared to the static AR experiences. Now let us look at the different types of AR. We have marker-based, markerless, projection, superimposition. Let us look at them one by one, so that we understand them really clearly and easily. Starting with marker-based AR, also known as image recognition, because as you can see in this example, that is a simple image. Our camera scans that image, and in our phone, tablet, or PC, we can see a real-life example or a real-life model developed from that. Now, this simple image can be a QR code, or it can be an image, any special sign, anything which the user can actually scan. In fact, this kind of marker-based AR is very easy to implement, and it can be done in very, this has been a very forming foundation for our image recognitions, especially one example of this is the drones. And when the drones are flying, if you want to tell the drone where to land, they use the same marker-based system as in this AR, but the drone lands on that particular side. Let us look at the markerless AR. Now, markerless AR are also called as location-based AR, and they work on the GPS or a compass or a gyroscope. Their basic aim is understanding a particular location and giving the user an information all about that particular location. Here you can see, you point at the Eiffel Tower, you get example about it. You get all information about it. A recent example which I can give you, which they are recently developing in Britain, I guess, is they're developing a mall, and once they have an app. So basically, when you scan that app or when you look at that app at one particular store, they will give you a virtual tour of that store without even entering that store. That's where you'll understand, do you even want to go in that store or not? Then we have the projection-based AR, something which we've grown up with. These Star Wars holograms or all kind of holograms and the cool things which we thought as kids, these are projection-based AR. So we have the synthetic light, which actually interacts with the physical surfaces. and some kind of actions happen. So R, the light is the input, or the interaction with the line is the input, if I want to be more specific, and the moving of the AR of those holographs is the output. Last but not the least, we have the superimposition based AR, something which is, this concept has gained quite a lot of popularity. Well, in superimposition based AR, we take our world and we see who superimpose different objects in it. We try to make those objects a part of our own world. A very good example given here is the IKEA. IKEA launched this app and they had significant sales and significant rise in their particular sales due to this app, where you could scan your whole background or your whole living room, and you could take different models of those chairs and arrange them in your living room and just see that, do you like this setting or not? In this, one very important thing which you need to know is the object recognition. Superimposition based AR can't work without object recognition. We'll talk about that in the later sessions. Let us look at the layers of augmented reality, or the mechanism. How exactly does this AR work? Well, we have the scene understanding. What is a scene? A scene is basically that environment in which all of your effects will take place. For example, if you want to conduct a play, you will have a scene, then you'll bring the cast and the characters. So understanding the scene is really, really important. In that, there are two important things. First is the plane testing, where your camera device tries to understand which all are the planes, which all are the floors, which all are the walls. Then we have the hit testing. In hit testing, they try to understand different kind of objects. Like, this is the bed. This is a very small vase. So like I explained in superimposition AR, this is very important because I want to project a particular small ball in my living room. My AR device should understand this, that the ball can be projected on top of the sofa, or it should be added in layers if done, so that it's not on the sofa, it is front of the sofa. To understand that, these both techniques are really important. Next, we have the tracking. Tracking is basically what links the physical and the digital world. We have different kind of tracking. We have orientation, position, object, people, facial. Let me give you an example. How exactly does tracking work, or why is tracking so important? Now, assume you've set up the scene. We have decided that as I raise my eyebrows, confetti should fall. But how will my AR understand that I have raised my eyebrows? So that tracking, that I have raised my eyebrows and now is the cue that the confetti should fall, is what basically tracking does. We have different hand trackers. A very good example of hand trackers is Titan had launched an augmented reality experience where you could try different watches on your hand, where they used hand trackers. Last, we have the rendering. So we have set up the scene. We've brought our objects in our real world. I have that small ball sitting in front of my sofa. But as a user, how will I find this augmented reality experience better? That the way to do that is only when the ball looks realistic enough to exist in real life. And for that, there are two important things which I should know. The material of the ball, as well as lighting conditions. And that is called as rendering. Rendering is where AR faces most of the problem, because if you want really high amount of rendering or high computing power, our mobile phones don't support it, which virtual reality does. And that's why virtual reality has more realistic elements as compared to AR. Let me explain it a bit more further. I have a ball, but it should look like plastic. The material should be plastic. I can't have a ball which looks like a metal. The user won't believe it, that this is a real ball. In a different kind of studios, like I am using Spark AR Studio, in that we have different filters and we have different parameters. So if I adjust the opacity, solidity, color, as well as the material in the proper proportion, 60-40-60, you will get proper, very good plastic. It looks like plastic. Now it's okay, I have that plastic ball created. But if you notice in real life also, light falls and these objects bounce off light, they reflect light. In that case, I should be having these particular light conditions where I should know that what ray of light will bounce off from what part and how will the ball actually shine. How does plastic shine? In that case, they have given us small bulbs, or they even have LED lights. You can have those lights placed at very particular angles of that particular ball, they bounce off in that element. So that when our user uses or when our user imports that ball into the sofa, in front of the sofa, it feels very real. The more real experiences, better is the augmented reality application. Last, we have the applications of augmented reality. Let us first start with gaming. I have a very small video to show regarding a real example of gaming. Here, as you can see, that they have created small rectangles and the user or the small kids are supposed are expected to hit the ball at that rectangle. And once they hit the ball, the rectangle disperses. This is something which they can use. Another example of augmented reality would be Pokemon Go, as I had previously mentioned. Next, we have the virtual dressing rooms, where you need not dress up to imagine how you would look in that particular type of clothing. Then we have the retail. As I had told you, that IKEA has created this where you have a blank bedroom and you can actually imagine or visualize how your bedroom would look like. You can try placing different elements. You have a bedroom ready and then you actually go and buy. And the best part about this is that you can change the size. You can change the alignment. You can scale it up or down. So that way it works with like real objects and it saves lots of time as well as money. Then we have the jewelry campaigns. Recently, they have started this try on jewelry where you need not buy that jewelry to imagine how it will look like. Same thing, Lakme has a try on filter where you can try on different lipsticks just to imagine yourself or visualize yourself how you look in those particular lipsticks. We also use it in medicine, in education, where you can see the working of a heart by scanning just a small image of a heart on a textbook. That way we understand the real elements of it. Using small devices and very less cost of money, because these are like normal apps like WhatsApp or Facebook. In fact, there are educational filters provided by Facebook as well as Instagram. Okay, looking ahead. Let's talk about what are the challenges augmented reality faces on the general scenario. And what does it have in its future, where you have the opportunity to work? First of all, we have the three basic challenges. We have content. Now, the problem with AR is you need to develop very realistic content. And for that, you should know 3D modeling. Not everybody does know that. And there are very few free versions of these models available. And if they are, and if there is somebody who wants to work or who has this artistic creativity, even if they can visualize that element, even if they can draw the element, they need to learn that particular modeling software to know how to do that. Once you get a hang of it, it's very easy, but learning is a task. Then we have the display issues. Problem with display issues is that we have a very small computer screen or we have a tablet. At the end, our view is restricted. As I said, you look here, it doesn't exist. You look in the screen, it does exist. So they're trying to develop these spectacles I'm talking about, where you look everywhere and it just works according to the user. Last, we have the performance issues. As I told you in rendering, that if you need high amount of rendering, you require high computing power. But our devices, the devices which we use day-to-day life, are not computable power enough. And that is why we need to work with models with a bit less specificity and a bit more adjustment. All of these issues is something which everybody is working on. And if they get sorted, we'll enter a new domain of computing, which I'll explain in the next slide. Okay. So what exactly is the future? Well, as I told you that even a phone right now has more computing power than NASA. It still can't bring the visual elements used in virtual reality in our own real world. That's why they're working towards a new form called a spatial computing, in which a head-mounted device we need to wear that device and interaction happens in a very real format. We have devices, like we have AR handsets, as I told you, of Magic Leap 1, which I would really appreciate if you try checking it out. We also have Nreal, it won't be long when actually spatial computing has a boom. This was all about AR. Let us now talk about Spark AR or the Spark AR Studio powered by Facebook. It is an augmented reality platform for Mac as well as Windows, and it allows you to create effects for your mobile cameras. Now, Spark AR allows the creators, or you and me, who is interested, who want to create something, and allows them to publish, manage, as well as track all these effects. The best part about the studio is something which I have written from my own experience, is that you can build it with or without code. Let me explain the statement. So basically, if you want to add interactivity, or if you want to animate it, or if you want to add textures and materials, you need not write a single line of code. Everything is very GUI friendly, but if you are that person who wants to delve deeper and you think coding is your forte, they do allow you to do custom animations using JavaScript. Suppose there are some ready-made textures, but I don't want this texture. There is a texture available of metal, but I want a very specific kind of metal. It allows me to do that also with specific lines of codes. And if not, I already have things created for me. Then it allows you to import different kind of sounds, different kind of videos. Lastly, it also helps you to manage all your effects. It helps you to publish your effects on Instagram as well as Facebook. And that too at the same time. In the sense, you create an effect, you go to the Spark AR hub, you give them their effect, they ask you that which app do you want to publish it for. If you can choose the option of Facebook as well as Instagram, because both belong to the same family, and that in this way you have your effect on two apps, that is more amount of user interactivity. Here is a very simple example I've given. Well, as you can see, you can decide that what do, how you want to animate it, what position do you want to keep that. You just need to select everything. If you want, you can even create it via custom. But for somebody who is starting or who is a beginner, this is a very easy GUI. Now, the difference between Spark AR and Lens Studio, where you Spark AR is for Facebook and Instagram, Lens is for Lens is for Snapchat. Both have almost the same functionalities, where everywhere you'll need. Lens has the same thing where you can animate, where you can create different kind of effects. The only difference is you just need to learn a hang of it. And if you know one application, learning second won't be difficult. This is one more example. The best part about Spark AR is that they give you some filters or some templates already created. So that way you can actually use your interactivity and your creativity in creating something new on the basis of something which is already created. For example, we already have in Spark AR a makeup template. So you just need to select a lipstick color, a blush color, or what kind of lighting do you want, what kind of beautification you want. So this, in that way, your combination is what actually matters. Not that you need to create a specific kind of code for deciding, okay, I'm going to decide a lipstick color. It's already there. You just need to choose. Or for example, you have those floating lights like the fireflies one. There you can replace, instead of those floating lights, bubbles, and you get a bubble filter. If you want, you can replace them using small confetti and you get the whole confetti particles and you get the whole confetti. The best part about these floating particles, which I personally found, was that you can decide the velocity with which they fall, the direction. Do you want it in opposite? Do you want in what layers? Do you want that some particles will be in front of the user, some will be behind the user? We also have the face distortion filters or the face mask filters, where we have those bunnies and everything. And lastly, we have different kind of models available on trying out these filters. You can even try out these filters on your own camera, but your different kind of models are available. Different kind of phones are also available. So if you want to, there is a list given that I want to try it on iPhone 8. So they'll give you the complete user interface of how iPhone 8 looks like. In fact, they will generate a preview link for you. You can send those preview links to a top 100 users. Those users can try the filter out for you. You can then take their feedbacks, and then at last you can send it out for publishing. Now let me talk about the School of Innovation. School of Innovation is powered by Facebook as well as the SVCO, that is the Official Silicon Valley, which is the host of the largest contingent of Indian students. Every year they come up with a reality program. Last year it was augmented reality. The year before that it was virtual reality. their basic aim is making students understand how does Spark AR work and what in its adoption as well as its engagement. Let me walk you through the process. Well, the number of students who applied last year when I gave was 10,580. The number of students who were selected were 500. But let me explain you the process. It is not difficult. And it is really easy if you really want to get it. Well, the first thing is the MCQ round. The best part about this MCQ round is there is no coding. You can't prepare for this round because the questions are very logical and very application-based. Let me give an example. Now, I remember two questions which I had. The first question was they had shown five objects. They had shown a light source and they had asked me that how will the shadows look like? Now, you can't prepare for such kind of questions. It is something which you've learned all through your age, all through your life, and you apply it. Or the second question was a very 7th standard scholarship question where there were two dices and they had shown different faces of the dices. And they'd asked me that what number will be appositive to. Simple questions. Next, we have the interview round where we need to prepare. But they won't be asking you that what is augmented, they'll ask you what's augmented reality, but they won't ask you, tell me how it works, because they want you to teach that. What they will even though look at it was the perspective and the approach with which you look at a problem. Is it suitable for somebody who wants to become an augmented reality developer? One question which they asked me was, now assume that you want to superimpose the image, superimpose the Mona Lisa painting. What all factors will you look upon on? So my answer, I don't know how right it was because we never discussed after that, but was that we'll consider where are we placing that. So the planes will be important. The lighting will be important. We'll also look at the different textures. That the painting, what kind of paints does it have? What kind of colors does it have? Is it tattered at the ends? Does it have an oil finish on it? A very simple approach-based questions will be asked. Third round is the onboarding. After you receive your acceptance and it's done in the pair of tools, two people form a team from a college and then you go and then you apply. In the onboarding, you'll have a talk with all of the members, eminent members from the AR industry. You'll be assigned mentors. These mentors are responsible for making sure that you understand what is happening, and if you have any kind of doubt, they are there to solve it. Then starts your journey of 11 weeks. It has an 11-week curated course on Pupil First. In fact, there is a course named as AR 101 on Pupil First, which is free of cost. So if you really like AR after this session, you can go and you can enroll yourself into the course. This is an extended version of the course which we had. So in our course, all the courses were industry curated. They were application-based and very close guidance was given. Every week we were sent a series of videos. Since COVID came and everything was very virtual, we were sent a series of videos. We were given a very lifelike assignment, like create a crown filter this week, create a joker filter next week. So everything was very creation based. You learn something, you apply something. And if I don't know that in a week, I have at least you could session calls with your mentors. At least once a week, the mentor used to call you. You had to explain what you understood. You're trying to explain the assignment for this week. How are you trying to approach the problem? Are you on the right track? So it was a very close-to-close interactive business. And lastly, they also had an FAQ site where all these students could discuss their own problems in these assignments. The assignments weren't easy, but they were very intellectually stimulating. Like at the end of the week, you would be very happy that you got done with this section. The different kind of topics which they covered, they started from what is AR, how does AR work. Then they taught us Blender. Blender is used for 3D modeling. 3 weeks we spent on Blender. 2 weeks are spent on creating a lifelike model plane. Trust me, girls, it is not easy. Because when I thought that, okay, let's start with the model plane, how difficult will it be? You had to construct every small wheel and every small rotor of that plane. You had to animate that plane. You had to imagine how a plane will work, how will the physics look like, and everything from a very logical point of view. There were no math formulas or everything. It was just how is your imagination working and how real life can you make it sound. after that, we started with the Spark AR. We imported those objects which we created into our own applications. We created filters. And lastly, at step 11, they urged us to publish at least one filter on Instagram or Facebook. Round 5, the highlight of everything, after learning and everything, cherry on the top, was the capstone project. Let's look at the next slide to understand better. Well, in the capstone project, these were our project partners, which were really, the names were released at the end of 11 weeks. So it was a very exciting business because we had for Travels Hostel, Chumbak, we had Jordanian, Nika, as well as UNICEF. For each of these weeks, every week you were given a specific grade. And after that grade, cumulative grades, you were ranked. And the top people were given the first come first choice. I was given the choice, and I having my own bias, or I having my calling for social work, I had chosen UNICEF. Let me explain what these project partners expected from you. So they had, at the end of 11 weeks, in the 12th week, they had session these calls with the head of these departments in India. So UNICEF India or Hostel India. And you had a call with them. They would explain their requirements, and you were needed to create the some specific filters for them. Now, Zostel is basically a hostel brand, a hotel brand to be more specific. So they needed a filter where the users can just have a tour of their Zostel home, I guess, is what they call, with sitting at your own home without actually going there. Chumbak has these artistic elements in bags. So Chumbak wanted some very specific filters or some very specific stickers, which would make their own brand very, which they could publish on Facebook or Instagram. People would use it and it would be very famous. Jordanian wanted Nazir as a superimposed image in the filter so that you can talk or you can just play around with him. Then we had Nika. Nika wanted something different. Nika didn't want a makeup filter because that is something which they already did. They wanted something different in the terms of you use a skincare brand or you use some specific product and how will your skin look like? One idea which my friend implemented was initially they show your real face without any filters and everything. Then they'll show you one specific product. When you try clicking on that product, it starts with bubbles and everything. And then your face, you start cleaning it. It was a face wash thing what you worked on. And after that, there are water droplets showing that your face has been clean. And after that, should apply the beautification filter to show that how your face will look, how glow will come on your face. Lastly, we had UNICEF. Well, UNICEF expected from me two kind of expectations. I could choose either of them. The first one, what they expected was teaching or raising awareness about COVID. At that point of time, COVID was really famous. And the second part was helping raise awareness to the health workers or these ASHA workers about these specific guidelines about COVID. Now, in the terms of raising awareness, one app which they were already using, which I found very fascinating, but I couldn't find the video, I'll describe it for you all, was that when you open your AR filter, it measures 6 feet radius from all around you. And if anybody is in that radius, it starts a buzzer. It was something which they gave us an example about. Now, let us talk about some effects which I have published in the course of last 1 year, or some effects even I published during while I was learning. They are very easy. The reason behind me showing that is you just need to learn. And if you are a beginner, I would suggest go with templates. One template, you get a hang of it in 2 to 3 hours. There are lots of tutorials available. After that, if you work on that template, you can send it to Instagram and Facebook. And in 2 to 3 days, you will have a filter on your own name published. Okay, this is the name of the filter. So basically, if you type this particular name on Instagram or Facebook, my filter will pop up. I would really appreciate if all of you use that filter and give me feedback because I'm on the path of progress myself. I'll be explaining the filter. Very basic mechanism. This was something which I created in my 4th week. Here I have a mask where the basic tactic or the main catch was creating a mask which was translucent enough to show the skin as well as the color. Then we have the confetti falling. And then we have the nose, which the size of the nose increases as wide as you open your mouth. So here you can understand a tracker is the size of your mouth. I'll just play it out for you all. This is a filter which all of these filters are widely available on Facebook as well as Instagram. Okay. Next in line, we have the soul into the sky filter. This was that plane which I mentioned before. We had to create this plane, give it a very metallic feel, give those propellers a plastic feel. And after that, they asked us to scale the plane up and down. And if you press on it, it tries to fly. You can get a more hang of the, I'm showing a very small video. If you want, you can use the filters and you can see how it actually works. So here you can scale the filter in real environment. You can make it big, you can make it small. And if you press on it, it starts to fly. In this way, you can use animations as well as the objects in it. Next in line, we have, this is the filter which I created for UNICEF, where initially you have a soap and you have corona particles. And when you press on it, a timer starts. And when you long press, the soap starts rubbing on your hand. Your hand was a tracker. And all the bubbles come to indicate that you're washing your hands. And after 20 seconds, that is the limit which has been advised, there is lots of confetti saying that you're safe now. And that's my brother in the video. So here is how the timer is started. And once 20 seconds get over, you get this thing where you're safe now and you have lots of heart confettis. Confetti hearts all belong to the floating particle categories. And one second, I have a last filter to show to everybody. I guess this is the filter which will be the easiest to work on. This is something which I created recently because why not? This is the filter. This is the template which I mentioned, the makeup filter template, where you can choose different kind of lighting effects and different lipsticks. Here I have worked on 5 different looks, 5 different lipstick, blushes, eyeshadows, looks, and you can try it out. I guess if you want to start, this is something I would recommend everybody to start with because it is very easy.
I ain't tryna. Yeah, ain't tryna be cool like you, wobbling around in your high heel shoes. I'm clumsy, made friends with the floor. 2 for 1, you know a bitch by 4, and 2 left feet, you know I.
I'll list the names to you. First of all, we have the silly clown filter. Then we have the soar into the sky filter. Then we have the rogue filter. And lastly, we have the hands_20 filter. And the best part about it is that after publishing these filters, which I'm assuming you all will be easily able to, once you publish it, there are 3 basic things which Facebook allows you to do so, which is the impression that once you open Instagram or Facebook, how many times was your filter shown? Captures is how many times were actually pictures taken. They also show, were those pictures shared? It also shows that were those pictures saved in your camera. Here I have a small snapshot of my filters where you can see that 4.8k times the impression were done, 11.4k. We had lots of opens. The captures were 1.6, 280 of them saved it. And at the end, I would like to conclude by saying that I hope that you all have gained an insight about AR, how easy it is. Even though it's a buzzword, it's not very difficult to understand at base. It is worked on pure logic. And I hope that I come across your filters by the next session. Thank you. Any questions?
So guys, if you have any questions, please be free to type the same in the chat box and she'll answer each and every one of them.
Okay. About the career opportunities in AR and VR. The best part about AR and VR in general scenario right now, as I told, is all these mega giants, Google, Facebook, Amazon, or even IKEA, all of them are picking it up. So if you decide to do a career in AR, it will start, it will start from very basic. You can either become somebody who develops those 3D models. You can even become somebody who just uses those 3D models and you work on the creativity of these particular filters. This is all about filters. Let's just talk about something else right now. If your filter becomes very popular, they give you money and everything about it. But if you want to work in, you name the industry and you have AR in it. If you want to work in education, you can create an educational application. If you want to do in medicine, there are open heart surgeries which are done via this. If you want to do retail, you can work for IKEA. If you go to Google is working on VR, especially more. It's working with the Magic Leap thing, which I told. It's been very secretive about it. But since by the time y'all will graduate, I personally think that there will be lots of opportunities available, because first and foremost, it's an up and growing industry. Even though it's very easy, people aren't aware of it. So the competition is a bit less. The second thing is that you need to, like when we go and when we need to show the different kind of projects we have done. We need to show the different kind of codes we have undertaken. But in terms of AR, you need to show what kind of different filters you've worked upon, what kind of different games you've developed. AR has a very, very important use in the gaming industry, because right now, as you know, that games have very heavy visuals and everybody is very devoted to laptops. But AR is that one game, AR is that domain which will take you away from the laptop, like how Pokemon Go did. Pokemon Go had a big hype just because it made people move. So for any, you can, best part about AR is working in AR is one domain, but choosing where to work in AR is something which you can find your calling as. You like fashion and you want to work in AR, you have something. You like technology and you like to work in AR, you can work as a backend developer where you provide options. Like there are these animated options, right? You can work as that developer who will provide those animated options to people. Okay. The coding part of AR. Well, the filters which I developed, the rogue filter, the silly clown filter, didn't require any kind of JavaScript. My plain filter and Hans 20 filter required. Hans 20 filter required JavaScript in customizing those bubbles and how would they flow. While my plain filter required JavaScript because I had to angle that plane at a particular moment and I had to move it. But JavaScript at a very basic level, guys, trust me on this, because I was a person who was always working in Python. So I learned JavaScript during that 1 week where they taught us. So JavaScript is not something which you need to delve deeper in if you don't want to. You have things available for you. And the courses, there is this Pupil First AR 101 course, which has a similar, which is a very small version of what we learned. And also there are a few online net tutorials available. There aren't any books or anything for AR because it's new. But if you really want to go in the terms, you want to go and learn filters, there are lots and lots of people who have created their own filters, and it's on up to us. Like, you can decide that, oh, I want this timer thing which he learned, I will learn it from them. And you can create and you can take bits and pieces from everybody and learn it. Also, you can go for the Spark AR Hub. Spark AR Hub has this whole blog where they teach you each and everything, right, from a very small example. You can go to Spark AR. They have this blog. They have different kind of tutorials where they'll take you from installing to the studio to creating and publishing your own effects. So the site itself is more than enough. And if you want to go beyond that, then there are people who have worked on YouTube and everything, and they've given small courses. But the site was properly enough for me. The site doesn't explain what is augmented reality, but I have. So I guess you can start from that. The name of the exam, Okay, the exam was a part of this whole course. So they circulate a form, actually, they circulate a form around March, I guess. Okay. They circulate a form around March where you have to go round by round, and it comes through the simple college mail. That was what was shared. Right now they are a bit more busy. So the best part about you people is that you'll get the form around May, I guess. Because right now the SVCO has teamed up with CBSC to give all the CBSC people a AR course. And that was something I was working with Cummins as well, but I guess that didn't take off. So if you want, I can have a proper group of sessions where I'll be teaching you each and everything what they taught me, because I was thinking of taking AR as a small subject, 5-day session subjects. Regarding what's the difference between Spark AR and AR Core? Well, Spark AR is very mobile-based limited. Like, you create just filters in Spark AR. With AR Core, you can create anything and everything what you want. AR Core is a bit more advanced. It has lots and lots of features. It is not limited just to the filters. But as I told, the user interactivity or the way to understand AR Core is a bit difficult. For beginners, I would recommend you can even start with Lens Studio if you are a Snapchat, and if you like Snapchat more. What was the very first AR project? Okay. The very first AI project was something which I hadn't worked at all in AR. So I was interested in AR. I didn't work. That's what I was telling everybody. It's not about the projects you do. Before School of Innovation, I had no idea about how to work in AR. All I knew is what is AR. And they legit taught me each and everything. So you need not be some kind of expert or even a beginner in AR. You just need to know, and you just need to have that will of learning and basic advance of technologies. While the project right now I'm working on, I'm right now trying to create a game where we all can go, like, it's a racing game where you can move the car according to your head, and with your blinks the car can change direction, or the tires, or you can change the models. That is something which I'm working on. The second filter, that is about the game aspect. The second filter which I'm working on right now is a mask filter where you have different kind of masquerade masks. And using your eye movements or your hand movements, you can change the dresses as well as the masks. Along with that, I guess, what was the question? Okay, some basic projects. So I would personally suggest, if we go in Spark AR, try the makeup one. Very easy. You don't require as much, I'll say, logic in that, because it's just colors. The second one which you can try is the floating particles, because floating particles will actually give you the feel of AR. They'll teach you physics. They'll teach you what AR can do. Especially the fireflies one, because they teach you glow. How exactly you will work with the glow, the luminous lights and everything. The third thing what you can work is the mask filters, because in mask filters you will learn how to handle physical aspects. Because when you create a mask, not the simple mask, like I want bunny ears. So you can get those bunny ears from net. You just need to type 3D model bunny ears. And I would suggest try out Blender for those who are really interested in 3D modeling, because Blender is really easy. It's a bit difficult for people who are more interested in the filters and not in the models. That way you can just go to 3d.com and you can just import the filters. But using those masks, you can take those masks, you can position it around the face, and it will teach you how should you deal with the physical elements. So if I have to suggest you, try very basic templates which are already there. Don't try with a blank project right now, and alongside, try learning whatever is taught on Spark AR site, because Spark AR site has almost everything which you can do right from the course. Side, okay. You can't like textures. Well, the best part about textures is that you can just import a texture and give it a overall feel. Like, for example, when I wanted to work on a marble texture, all you need is a very small compressed JPG of a marble texture right from the internet. You can just say a marble texture, You can download that. You just need to compress it because one, huh? Oh, thank God, I remembered. There is this one thing that you really need to have a very crisp KB size, GB size, because when you need to publish on Instagram or Facebook, you can't go for very high def nor very pixelated image. So you need to strike that balance. Once you push on upload, it shows that it shows you on the screen that do you agree to it or are you suitable enough to publish this filter. If not, you can just go to compress JPG and compress the image. One small image and you can apply the whole texture for your whole object. You need not go for a very there is no different texture site as such. You can just go on the net and download any, like, for as you have 3D models or anything for models, there texture is something which you can easily work around with. And for objects, I would suggest that now I was working with Blender, so dot blend was something which I had a restriction about. But if you go and if you put 3D models free import, you can have lots and lots of options. And the best part is, if you want Blender oriented, you can go around that as well. But 3dmodels.com work according to me. I use most of my filters from there. Okay, I guess we have a few questions. Could you just read them out for me, please?
Yeah, sure. Wait, I'll read them out. So we have a question. Can the filters made using Spark AR be exported to other platforms, or are they available only on Facebook apps?
Well, no, you can't export them to other platforms. You can export them, you can export them to the Facebook family of apps, that is Facebook and Instagram. In fact, Facebook had tried the Snapchat thing, and Snapchat very proudly refused. But right now, you can just work them on Facebook as well as Instagram. Not Snapchat. You need to go for something at Snapchat this.
So we have another question. Can we also do this AR stuff with GANs, GANs as well?
Well, you can do it with GANs. You definitely can do it with GANs, but that is a whole new domain, because with AR, like right now we are talking about very easier GUIs, right? Where you just need to take things and create. But when you go with GANs, it is very high level of coding. And if you're up for it, great. Because of GANs, you can go at a deeper level in the sense that with this all studios, you can create very realistic, fancy images. But with GANs, you can make those images move in a very advanced or customized manner, which these people can't, because they're trying to work on the mass appeal of the filters rather than the deep, like, it's more breadth wise. If you want GANs, you can go deep, you can go it depth wise. I would prefer this over GANs, because the other reason is the rendering with GANs is not very fancy, so it doesn't look real, like, as real like as compared to other, like, AR Core or AR Kit.
I guess we're done with the questions, and if anybody has any question, you can put up right now, or we can end the session.
Thank you so much, Kritika. It was great answering everybody's questions, because I really hope that y'all are into all of this, because it's not difficult. And guys, please wait. Please put Facebook School of Innovation. Try checking it out after, like, 1 month or 2 months, because I'm damn sure that they'll be uploading the form, and it's not very difficult to get in if you know your answers right and if you're not confused. Last year there were only 2 people. I really hope that this year we have lots and lots of, the exposure is really good. You can talk to industry experts, you can gain important sessions about it.
So, Rutuja, this was an extremely interesting session, and I personally just loved it. You know, most of the FIs and SYs, they're not really aware of these new emerging technologies, and they don't really know what is AR, VR. They're just, you know, they just heard about it from somebody, but they're all confused about it. But your today's session, it was so interesting, because you literally started from the basics. And that's what I loved the most about the session. And another thing you told us about Facebook School of Innovation, which I myself was not aware about. So thank you so much for that. And we are
really, really glad you liked it. And okay, there is somebody who asked the benefits of the course. Which course? Could anybody just specify what course were they talking about?
Maybe she is talking about Spark AR or something, AR or something like that. Can you please unmute yourself and, you know, elaborate the question?
If you want, we can address that, yeah. Okay, Spark AR course, the course which, the course, the Facebook School Innovation course. Well, they expected us to do a very real life application of the capstone project. And that's why they taught us everything from the basics. So it is something which is, I would personally prefer that even if you don't want to do a career in it, it is something which you can, which will make you stand out on a, which will make you stand out. It was something which I mentioned in my city interview. Why? Because that was a different skill. So apart from soft skills, if you want to go for technical skills, the skills which make you different, apart from the basic competitive coding, these are these different technology. Everybody prefers blockchain or AR or these skills because these are up and coming, a different domain, but still technology. So if you don't have interest in that also, you can still try exploring this because this will give you an edge. That's what I would prefer.
Great. So Rutuja, I'll request you to stay back until everyone leaves.
Okay, yeah, sure. Mm-hmm.